So, thank you very, very much for inviting me here, Marina, Jacques. Thank to the CISA for giving us this very nice environment, and I think it's a real honor to have the occasion to present you some experimental evidence concerning speech and language in the occasion of this honorary degree to Noam Chomsky that as a neurophysiologist, I was always considered this school of thought a little bit far from our approach, because obviously you can deal with language directly by considering its formal structure, while I reached the language starting from neurophysiological evidence, start from the study of the motor system. I think now is the moment of a real ecumenic vision. So I think it's the moment in which different disciplines should converge, because the different approach now can be unified by methodological rigorous experiments, and also because the evidence now coming from neuroscience are providing, I think, a lot of cues about the interpretation about the nature of the human language. So, just to make a joke with you, I show you why I started with language. This is one paper that we published 20 years ago, where we first reported the discovery of these strange mirror neurons, and I remember well that when we were in the lab and we had the occasion to find these neurons, Giacomo Rizzolatti was not in the room, and then we met him the day after, and we presented him a videotape of the neuron, and he said, "Ma, one neuron makes not the brain." So, but anyway, if this is true, this could be the neurological basis for the motor theory of Alvin Liberman, the motor theory of speech perception, in the sense that, as you can see here, as we wrote in this paper, in the premotor cortex, there are neurons which are endowed with the properties that such theory requires, so the motor theory of speech perception. It is interesting to note that the anatomical location of inferior area 6, where we found these mirror neurons, and in particular of area 5, corresponds in large part to that of Broca's area in the human brain. This is the starting point, obviously. We were very far from the evidence we have now. And starting from this idea, before I use a technique that maybe you know, which is TMS, transcranial magnetic stimulation, to demonstrate that in humans, during observation of hand actions, there was an automatic, implicit motor facilitation which was congruent with the observed action. And then I moved to speech, trying to demonstrate what happens, or to look at what happens in the human brain, in the human motor cortex, during passive speech listening. We use the game TMS. Is there a pointer? Oh, yes, this one. We use the game TMS. We provide the stimuli to the subject by using earphones, you see here. And we recorded EMG from the tongue, electromyography. And the idea was if we stimulate the motor cortex in the tongue region during listening, let's say, of a word like birra in Italian, which is beer in English. And obviously, when we pronounce the word birra, there is a very strong involvement of the tongue. And if we compare birra with, for example, with baffo, which when pronounced doesn't involve so strongly the tongue, we should find a difference in the amplitude of the motor evoked potential, or the motor potential evoked by TMS. And we use, you see, words and pseudo words, but this is not the argument of my talk today. As a control, we use some sounds trying to replicate the prosody and to provoke, obviously, an arousal in the subject, so it was not a problem of attention what we found. And the results were quite striking. On ordinates here, you see the amplitude of the muscle response evoked by TMS in the listener, and you see the difference in words and in pseudo words between words containing double R and words containing double F. So there is a very clear phonological effect. I don't deal here with the difference that we observed between words and pseudo words. This is a more lexical effect that is not the argument of today, but you see that this effect is very, very strong. Okay, so starting from this point, obviously this is a demonstration that the motor system is involved during listening, but it's not a demonstration that the motor system is involved in perception. There is many evidence in favor of this motor involvement during speech listening or motor facilitation during speech processing, and The most famous one is the McGurk effect. I think everybody here knows this effect, so if someone doesn't know, I can show you, but maybe we don't lose time. Everybody knows this? Okay. The McGurk effect, in my view, is interesting because, you know, it represents a conflict between a visual stimulus, in this case the classical stimulus was a subject pronouncing a ga sound, and an auditory stimulus, which is a ba sound, okay? By observing the stimulus, what the subject perceives is something in between. So the perception is a da sound, but this in between is in between in terms of articulatory effect. So it's something which is in the middle as far as the pronunciation of the sound is concerned. Other evidence. I like very much this paper, came out 3 years ago. In this paper, this is a discrimination task. So subjects are listening to a stimulus, which is, they hear the stimulus, which is a mixture of two English words, head and hard, okay? So you can create with the computer a mixture of these two with different percentage. Let's say here you had 100% of head, here you had 100% of head, and you have different percentage of this. When you are at five, you are at chance level. And subject have just to press one of two buttons to say if the stimulus was a head or a heart. The blue line represents the control condition. Very simple experiment. What they did in this paper is very nice. So during the listening of the stimuli, they simply stretched the skin of the face, okay? And subjects do perform exactly the same task, and you see that during stretching, the perception of the sound changes just by stretching the skin around the mouth. And a very similar effect was found not as by stretching the face, but by asking subject to perform sort of training, a motor training against a force field by using the tip of the tongue, you know, a sort of reaching with the tip of the tongue. And during after this training, again you see the perceptual displacement in this red line. So there is evidence, this is clear evidence of the interaction between the sensory and the motor during speech perception. Obviously, we have brain imaging data. This is a very famous data published by Marco Iacoboni's group in Natural Neuroscience a few years ago. Again, they presented, in this case, syllables, ideal, and they also dealt only with simple syllables or pseudo words, because otherwise there is this complication of the interaction with lexicon. And they found premotor activation during listening. And this is a very important paper, in my view, by Friedman, Pulver, Müller, who a few years ago demonstrated that not only the motor system is facilitated automatically during speech listening, but also that there is a somatotopic facilitation. This is the lip motor cortex and the tongue motor cortex, which are differentially involved, differentially facilitated during listening of, let's say, a da sound or a ba sound. Now, this is very, very recent data. We have a more direct evidence of this. These are recordings from the human brain. This is a system we set up in Genova, the IIT. And this is a sort of a micro electrocorticography system that we use almost every day in Udine in collaboration with Miran Scrap. And you see this small surface here. Here there are many, many micro contacts. And the dimension here is about 4 millimeters. So we have 64 independent contacts in 4 millimeter of side of the square. We have also other kind of systems. We can position this apparatus you see here on the human cortex exactly where before, by electrically stimulating the brain, we can find the motor region of the tongue. And during this task, obviously what we do, we record the subject performance, so the micro electrocorticography during the pronunciation of speech sounds, so the subject sees where there are the blue lines, for example, a stimulus presented on a computer screen, sees a da, and that's just to pronounce the da, or sees a ba, and that's just to pronounce the ba, okay? So the blue line represents the visual presentation of the syllable, the EMG in red, so muscles opening the mouth, and the sound produced by the subject, and this is the electrocorticography we record with our system. But what is striking is that by using this new system, new device, even on the basis of one single trial, we are able to decode, to classify the pronounced sound, so to say if the subject was saying a, let's say a da or a ba or a ga and so on, And we have a very nice distinction. For example, this is the distinction between the da sound and the ka sound during pronunciation, but the same is true also during listening. These are different patterns of the activation of the array during listening to different syllables. So I think this is the direct evidence of the fact that the motor cortex in humans is involved in both sides, during perception and during production. Anyway, these experiments suggest, but do not prove, that the motor system is involved in perception. You know the word correlational. Everybody says this now, okay? This is just a correlational demonstration that the motor system is active, but it could be also a sort of epiphenomenon. So, very recently, we explored the possibility to demonstrate that the motor system is causally involved in speech perception, and we performed an experiment that was published in Current Biology a couple of years ago, starting from the Pulver-Muller experiment on fMRI. You remember this somatotopic differential activation of the motor system during listening. We decided to use TMS not to measure the excitability of the motor cortex, but to interfere with the function of the motor cortex during a perceptual task. The task was very simple, was a speech discrimination task. We presented different syllables, let's say da, ba, ga, ta, and so on, and subject to press the corresponding button on a keyboard. Very simple task. During the task, in some trials, we administered TMS either on the lips motor cortex or on the tongue motor cortex. To make the task a little bit difficult, because otherwise we were worried about a possible ceiling effect, we added some white noise to the speech sound. Because if we don't put in speech the noise, we have about 95% of accuracy, which is too high. So we mixed to the speech sound that amount of noise, which provoke about 25% of errors. Okay? So we were at 75% of correct responses. You see in red here the TMS stimuli, which were which were administered 50 and 100 milliseconds before the beginning of the speech sound, not to interfere with the noise of the TMS. And these were the results. This is the ratio of the reaction times between TMS and non-TMS trials. It means that when you go up, means a slower performance, okay? In the TMS trial, when you go down means a faster performance, and there is very nice double dissociation. When we stimulate the tongue motor cortex, subjects were faster in discriminating dental syllable phonemes, and they were slower in discriminating labial phonemes, and the opposite, the reverse, occurred when we stimulated the lips motor cortex. Everything is significant. The same was true also for the number of errors. So, a very strong demonstration in my view that in this case the motor system is really involved in the speech discrimination, because when we disturb the motor system in this kind of task, we provoke, we change the performance of subjects. Obviously, what you find here is a facilitation of the motor system. And this is a little bit against the evidence that usually we see in literature after the use of TMS. We have the idea that TMS blocks, and this is true. But remember that here we stimulate the primary motor cortex, and I don't think the primary motor cortex is the motor center directly involved in this kind of perceptual processing. So probably what the effect we obtained here was provoked by a sort of excitatory volley that was sent from the primary motor cortex to other premotor centers, which in turn are facilitated by this TMS. A critical question. You remember the noise. Someone could say, okay, you find the effect because the task was difficult. And we did the task difficult because we were worried about the ceiling effect. Is this true in all listening conditions? So, for example, one possible interpretation is that simply the motor system intervenes as a sort of attentional mechanism to focus better on some specific characteristics of the speech sounds when the task is difficult. So we replicated exactly the same experiment more recently, and we published it this year, without the noise. Now the performance in 95% of correct responses. We removed the noise. Everything was exactly as before, so TMS 50 and 100 milliseconds before the speech sound. And these were the results. No more difference. No more effect, no more facilitation induced by the motor system. So, from this evidence, it looks like the motor system intervenes only when the task is difficult or only when the subject has to put more attention in the discrimination of the stimuli. Obviously, I'm not satisfied from this result. So, when we are not satisfied in science, we try alternatives. And we thought a lot on this. I remember a very nice discussion with Tom Bever in San Sebastian a couple of years ago about these results. And discussing with Tom came out with the idea that I think was very, very interesting. So why, in place of making the task more difficult by just modulating the amount of noise, we don't make an experiment in which we just increase the variability of the speakers? And this is what we did. These data are very, very recent. We are just writing the paper now. So what we did in this experiment, we selected a population of 30 different speakers, and we calculated for every speaker some phonological characteristic of their own speech. For example, these are the male coefficients, so it's a sort of principal component analysis distances. These are just F1 Forman distances. So, okay, we try to differentiate these subjects, and this red image is the subject that, for example, subject number one that was tested in the same experiment with TMS, and we selected the stimuli according to the distance from the speaker. So we replicated the experiment, we stimulated the lip and the tongue motor cortex during the discrimination task. Now the accuracy was 92%, so very close to the 95 I told you before, but now the difference is there. So it looks like in the case of the big variability of speakers, that is the normal physiological situation of our normal life, the motor system is for free involved in speech perception. At this point, the question is, which could be the premotor centers involved in this kind of motor perception? Just to use a term that was invented by Marc Jeanrot, or motor cognition, that I like much more. Which is the first candidate? If I make, give you a questionnaire, I am sure that the majority of you would answer the Broca's area. The Broca's area because it's known that is the motor center for speech production, but also because we know also from some presentation of this workshop, like that of Stan Dehan, that has also other properties. Broca's area for sure is involved in speech production. It was demonstrated by, apart from Broca, but it was demonstrated very nicely, for example, by Penfield during neurosurgery. Sometimes I don't show the video, but just to convince you, I want to show you what happens during electrical stimulation of Broca's area and electrical stimulation of different motor regions of the human brain during speech production. What you will hear is the patient, the brain of the patient is here, and you will hear the patient's voice while counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, in Italian, obviously. This was done again with Miran Scrappi in Udine. And you will see the effect of the stimulation of different cortical regions around this one, which is area 44. Pay attention to the fact that this is a right hemisphere. This was a right dominant. No problems. You know that a relevant percentage of people have right dominance for speech. And you will see the effect of stimulation of premotor cortex here. This is area 6. Of the primary motor cortex here, this is area 4. And the stimulation of Broca's area. I hope the sound works. No.
Uno, due, tre, quattro, cinque, sei, sette, otto, nove, dieci. Uno, due, tre, quattro, cinque, sei, sette, otto, nove, dieci. Uno, due, tre, quattro, cinque, sei, sette, otto, nove, dieci.
Okay, there are no doubts. At the same time, we know, for example, that electrical stimulation of Broca's area, so exactly the same. But imagine a task in which the patient has to answer questions about, has to answer to some question posed by the surgeon during the stimulation. So, in other terms, a comprehension task. And it is known from the literature, mainly from neurosurgery, obviously, that the electrical stimulation of BA44, you see here, can cause some deficit in comprehension of sentences. Never of single words, but of sentences, yes, particularly if are complex sentences in syntactic terms. But why Broca's area is a good candidate as well? You remember my first slide, this small note that we published about neurons. We already there, we cited the Broca's area, because indeed there is an anatomical similarity between the area 5 in the monkey and area 44, 45 in humans. But this is our first PET experiment we published by trying to see if a mirror system exists also in humans, and in the condition grasping observations minus object of observation, you cannot see this because it's quite dark, the slide, there is a small red hot spot here which was activated, and this was at the border between area 44 and 45. So Broca's area responded also to action observation. Not only, because we know that now this is a very nice paper that was published by Michael Petrillo a few years ago, studying the anatomical similarities between BA44 in humans and RF5 in monkeys, but Broca's area is also involved in many, many other tasks. You have seen something yesterday, obviously language production, language perception, music, evaluation of rhythm, working memory, syntactic distance, syntactic violations. I put here no memory load because this is an important point, because otherwise the possible criticism is that many of these conditions involve working memory, okay? Mathematical calculation, logical operation, you remember the very nice data by Luca of yesterday, action observation, again, no memory load, okay? So, Broca's area, I think, is a good candidate for us. But unfortunately, we did everything on Broca's area. We stimulated with trains, high frequencies, with TMS, obviously. We stimulated intraoperatorily to check if Broca's area is involved in understanding actions, in understanding speech, but however, we failed to find any involvement of BA44 in this kind of tasks. So, why Broca's area is a language area? At least for me, the question is there. Remember that when Paul Broca wrote his famous book in 1861, one of the most critical symptoms he noticed in the patient, the famous tan-tan, was obviously the aphasia, so the difficulty to speak, but also at the same time he noticed the agrammatism, and he was very clear in saying this. So the absence of a grammatic speech. So the speculation here at this point is that BA44, and this is the second part of my talk, could be endowed with a representation of action meaning in an effector-independent way because of its remoter origin. It will become more clear, I think, during my presentation. It may play a role in encoding-decoding action structure in broader terms. So, as a consequence, people with lesion of BA44 should be impaired in encoding-decoding action structure. So if we think that in BA44 there is a convergence in terms of, I would say, action encoding in very general terms, if it is true that BA44 is activated by observation of actions, we have to demonstrate that the lesion of BA44 causes an impairment in the understanding of the action of others. There is some evidence in favor of that, very approximative, I would say, evidence, because, for example, this very nice study by the Damasios was not anatomically accurate. They just took, if I remember correctly, more than 100 different patients, either with lesion of the frontal left or the frontal right brain, and they did a task like this one. For example, they imagined that they show these two photographs, these pictures, and they asked the patient which of the two situations makes more noise. It's clear to everybody which is the answer, okay? And what they found is that the left damaged patients were more impaired in this kind of task. Other evidence in favor of an involvement of BA4445 in the decoding or the encoding of the action structure. This is a very important paper in my view by the group of Georg Goldenberg, showing that the pantomime of the use of tools requires the integrity of the inferior frontal gyrus. And this is a more recent paper from the same group, which is really striking in my view. In this case, they asked a patient to use a new tool. Okay? The task is the following. You see this cylinder here. There is a ring on the top of the cylinder. And then the patient is presented with these three different tools. Only one, obviously this one with the hook, can be used to solve the task, which is to lift the cylinder. And look at the patient. This is a special permission that I obtained from Georg Goldenberg.
Können Sie da das eine aussuchen, das am besten geeignet ist, um das hochzunehmen? Ah ja, sehr gut.
This is the right tool, but the patient has no idea on how to use it. At least that
Also das ist das Richtige. Versuchen Sie es noch einmal.
Okay, so.
Ja.
In German, but.
Ja.
Da war schon die Hand dabei.
Ja.
Darf ich Sie mir noch mal zeigen? Okay.
So. I think it's very instructive, this video. Our particular experiment to try to demonstrate that the lesion of Broca's area affects understanding of action of others was a little bit different. We selected obviously aphasic patients, frontal aphasics. We started from an initial population of 20 very good aphasics as defined by the neuropsychological department of our hospital, and then starting from these 20, we arrived at 6 because we excluded apraxia, problem in the memory span, problem in the capability in sequencing numbers or letters, and so on. So at the end, we had 6. And you see the 6 superimposed lesions. Obviously, as in every case of patient study, you see this, for example, this purple lesion is half of the brain, okay? At least at this level of section. But anyway, what is nice is that the maximal superimposition is here. And this exactly corresponds to BA44 according to the probabilistic atlas of Catherine Ammons and colleagues. Okay? So the lesions are centered on BA44. Obviously, our task was not like that of Damasio, so we didn't ask anything to the patient. The task didn't require any kind of, verbal capability. We just asked the patient to put in the correct order some photographs taken from a video they saw before. Okay, they first see a video, and then they saw four pictures, and they have to touch the screen to put the picture in the right order. We had two different conditions, the experimental condition that were obviously human actions, and the control condition that were physical events. The complexity of the two conditions was absolutely comparable, and we checked this. What is interesting is that our population of patients was also tested with the standard neuropsychological tests, and you see, for example, the result of this naming task. These are the patients, these were the control, matched for age, scolarity, and so on, And these are, for example, this is a naming task for objects. You see the performance, 9.5 out of 12 stimuli is quite good. But when you look at the naming of tools, 3.8 out of 8. And when they had to name the use of the tool, the situation became dramatic. Okay? Look at what happens. This is just one example.
Incoraggiato.
You see the video, the guy opens the door.
Bravo.
So then you see the four pictures, and then just touch the screen. I'm wrong, he says. It's the only right thing that you...
Lo posso sistemare quanto vuole. Ecco, questo qua è ecco, guarda.
Il cane non sta qui.
Posso vedere che c'è? No, no, è quello già a posto.
If you put numbers there, they do this.
E qua, è a posto, schiaccia già.
Put the photograph of a bicycle falling down, they do it. If they put the door opening by itself, they do it. And this is the reason why they don't realize why it's so difficult to solve the task when there is a human being opening the door. It's not a problem of, let's say, for example, agent and object, because also we tested the same by using object acting upon other objects, okay? It's not this the problem. The problem is a sort that they are absolutely unable to embody themselves in this kind of action. Because to solve the task, you have to put yourself in the shoes of this actor in order to understand how and which are the phases of the action. And these were the global results, quite clear. While in the case of physical events, the patient behave exactly like the controls, in the case of human actions, the controls somehow benefit from the knowledge about the stimuli, from the internal representation of what the stimuli that are presented, while the patient, you see, are quite badly performing. Okay. A drop of water. Also because it's a concept for force. We replicated exactly the same experiment in normals by using TMS. I don't want to lose time on this. Anyway, we just slightly changed the task. We presented three pictures and we asked the subject to indicate which is in the middle, okay, of the motor sequence. Okay, we replicated the same. And then we recently performed two new experiments that we published that I think could be interesting, particularly when I think to what I listened yesterday and today. So the idea is that you can have a sequence of stimuli like this one, and you can ask subject to perform a motor learning task. You will see we have two different kinds of motor learning. The sequence we selected, this experiment were done in collaboration with Etienne Olivier in Brussels, the stimuli we selected contained some structures, so some chunks, and subject were absolutely not aware of the existence of these chunks. So, the first experiment was very simple. Imagine this is a computer screen here. This position lights on, and the subject, who has four buttons in front of him, has just to press the corresponding button. This is the task. So there is a sort of implicit motor learning, which is performed by the subject, and during this task, we stimulated with TMS either a control site, this is the vertex, so the somatosensory cortex, the foot region of the somatosensory cortex, and BA44, left Broca's area. Sorry, left BA44, the Broca's area. And these were the results of this first experiment. This is the learning curve. This is the block number. And you see that when we stimulate the control site, you have a very nice learning curve, while when we stimulate BA44, learning is impaired. Okay, this is an implicit learning. What happens to the chunking structure? Nothing. There is never a difference between red and green, no statistical difference. In other terms, when the task is an implicit learning, TMS over broadcast area do not affect the performance in this, I would say, implicit learning of chunk or chunking pattern. We repeated the experiment, now it's a little bit different, because in this case subjects had to explicitly learn a sequence. So they were presented, let's say, with two locations on the computer screen, then they have just, by chance, obviously, to select one of the two, and then they are instructed if this one is correct or not, by a green or a red signal. So, step by step, they slightly learn the sequence. Obviously, again, they are not aware of the chunking structure. And what happens is here, as far as the learning curve, you see almost the replication of what I showed you before. So stimulation of BA44 affects the learning, but now there is a highly significant effect on the implicit learning of the chunking structure. I leave for discussion this. I think it's quite interesting. And now the last part. The last 10 minutes. Ideas and speculations. So, why I think this second part of my talk is relevant as far as language is concerned. The first part I think is clear why it's relevant for speech. Look at this. This is a very simple schematic drawing of how we see the structure of an action. You have different levels. You have the goal representation here, you have motor acts here, you have motor synergies here. This could be, for example, the spinal cord or even some part of the primary motor cortex. And obviously, if you are interested in language, you see here a tree-like structure, which is a hardware, this is very important for me, a hardware tree-like structure. You can combine this action representation into complex actions, obviously. You can create very complex trees, which are now a mixture of hardware and software. And obviously, this is the very famous review by Anirudh Patel on the similarities between language and music as far as syntax is concerned. What I think is that, obviously, at the basis of these syntaxes, one possibility is that the motor system is there, and because of this hierarchical syntactic structure, because there are brain centers which are involved in governing this structure and using this structure. And this is just the starting point. Anyway, the sharing of syntactic properties between action and language is not, in my view, a matter of motor planning, but it's a matter of motor structure. What I want to say is that, obviously, if you have to analyze the sentence, I want to get breakfast, you can decompose this into sub-elements, which are motor acts. I have to prepare the coffee, and then to prepare the coffee, I have to put the powder in the coffee machine, and so on. This is not what I mean here. This, in my view, is quite trivial, because you use language to describe a motor procedure. What I think is that if you look at the organization of the motor system, for example, you go and record neurons from the premotor cortex in the monkey, you see that there are neurons which are able to generalize the goal. This is a neuron that we recorded a lot of years ago, responding, for example, when the monkey was grasping a small object with the right hand, a small object with the left hand, but not when the monkey was grasping a big object, by using almost the same muscles. Okay? So there are also neurons which respond when the monkey grasps with the right hand, left hand, and the mouth. So this means that we are not at the muscle level here. This is the top level, as far as I know, in the monkey brain. And you go down and down and down, and you find and you try to understand which is the language that this premotor neuron uses to address the right synergy, which are downstreams. So the motor system is a hierarchical structural system where upstream elements, more and more capable of generalization, must know the right language to address and merge downstream synergies. And this is a pure speculation, obviously. Human broadcast area could therefore be a very generalizing premotor cortex, premotor in origin. This could be the basic structure. I suggest you to read this paper. It was published by eight years ago. And it's a paper by Tommaso Poggio and Emilio Bizzi, both working at the MIT, trying to formalize what I'm trying to say you now. Look at the abstract. Learning is more than memory. It is not simply the building of a lookup table of labeled images, or a phone directory-like list of motor acts and the corresponding sequence of muscle activation. Central to learning and intelligence is the ability to predict, that is, to generalize to new situations beyond the memory of specific examples. The key to generalization, in turn, is the architecture of the system, more than the rules of synaptic plasticity. We propose a specific architecture for generalization for both the motor and the visual system, and so on. Let's jump from the motor cortex or from the visual cortex to the spinal cord. This is the spinal motor neuron, what Sherrington called the final common pathway. And this is the simplest motor sensory motor structure, which is the stretch reflex, okay? You know the doctor which used the hammer on your knee. Look at the level of convergence that we have here. This is an already hardware-built structure which provokes monosynaptically, with just one synapse between the sensor and the motor sites, a response to one stimulus. Very simple, the simplest way. But you can also look, for example, at another reflex, which is the pain reflex. You walk on the beach and you find a piece of glass. Okay, you go, ah! Okay, you raise, you lift your leg, but this reflex of lifting provokes at the same time, because of hardware structures, the stimulation of the extensor of the contralateral limb, obviously the flexors here, the inhibition of the flexor of the contralateral limb, and the inhibition of the extensor of the ipsilateral limb. This is a hardware structure that, for example, is used by the locomotor central pattern generator to produce the locomotion, because it's already there. So the CPG center doesn't need to individually control every muscle, every motor neuron to produce one step. So the structure is an hardware hierarchical structure. This is a joke. I skip this. I don't have time. No, maybe later, but if you want, better. But anyway, the answer is that animals don't speak, but they are already capable of very complex motor behaviors. Because we have the idea that a monkey or a chimpanzee behave almost like human in motor terms, but we have the language as an additional miracle. I think this is true. I'm not obviously saying that this is not true. But animals can move and produce very complex behaviors even without the brain. These are very famous papers, okay, showing, for example, that also spinalized frogs, okay, are able to show very complex motor synergies, like a scratching reflex. This is for me, was an astonishing paper. You put an irritant substance here, and you cut first the brain. Okay, it's just a spinal cord. And obviously, the leg of the frog removes the stimulus. This was shown by Sherrington. But when you move the location of the elbow, this automatically changes the pathway of the scratching reflex. And this is without the brain. Imagine what the brain could add to this structure. And at this point, the critical question, did happen something in the human sensory-motor architecture which may parallel the revolution of language? Is there something new and typically human that may justify an analogy between the two systems? I thought a lot of this, and yesterday I got the solution, at least I think. I got one possible solution. This is a very famous paper by Kuipers. He's an anatomist, a physiologist, so a boring person, okay, like I am. And in this paper, they just studied the distribution of what we call corticospinal projections. So, are the projections coming from the motor cortex? In the case of these animals, there is no motor cortex. They have sort of sensory-motor amalgama. The rat has a motor cortex for the whiskers, but this is a different story. Okay, just look at the projection from the motor cortex to the spinal cord, and look which is the destination of these projections. Look at the opossum. This is the corticospinal pathway, and this is the destination in the dorsal sensitive horns. So this means that the opossum, in order to move, actuates the same muscle synergies or motor neuronal synergies that are used by reflexes. As I told, I was telling you before. Look at the cat. More and more you go along phylogenesis, the cat has more destination in the intermediate region of the spinal cord, where there are interneurons. The monkey, the macaque monkey, now you see some very few projection in the ventral motor cords. The chimpanzee has much more projections in the ventral horn. And what happens here, different from here, and particularly in humans, it happens that there is a new cortical area, which is the primary motor cortex. And the primary motor cortex, you see, this is the human, the very famous Penfield homunculus, and this is the Hulsey sinusculus. And if you look at these two representations, you see that in humans, you have a very huge hand with respect to the rest of the body, a very huge face, because we are able to express emotion with our face, a very huge tongue and mouth, because we are able to speak. But which is the difference between this situation and this one? Is that those representations here gain a direct access to the spinal motor neuron. So in other terms, don't use the motor synergies. They have to make a more complex task. They have to contact directly the motor neurons and take care of the organization of individual movements. But we are able to move one single joint, and the monkey will never move one single joint. This is a critical point in my view. And this new organization, this new product of evolution, frees the sensory motor system from the rigidity of synergies. By paying a price in terms of efficiency, obviously animals are much faster than us, our species gain new capabilities, that for example to invent new action and reactions, to gain in redundancy, to explore new solutions, and so on. And these new capabilities are provided by an extremely complex sensory motor machinery whose computational potentialities could be recycled for cognitive purposes as well. This is a pure speculation. But this speculation is sometimes substantiated by a seminal work by an almost completely ignored neuroscientist, anatomist that was Friedrich Sanides, who studied the cytoarchitectonics of the cortex and reached the conclusion, almost 30 years ago, that what we call primary areas, primary visual cortex, primary motor cortex, are not the more simple cortical areas, are the latest product of evolution. And this is a critical point. So it looks like the differentiation between sensory and motor is a recent product of evolution. So in other terms, to conclude my presentation. So if a rat wants to drive, okay, the rat must use an already built car. There is the synergy which forces the rat to behave in a given way, okay? These direct cortical motor neuronal projections provide us with the Lego bricks that can be assembled and merged to build the car we prefer, so a blue beetle, as in the case of the poor rat, or even a yellow smart. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for the exciting talk. We have again 10 minutes for questions. So that was long ago, but the claim that Lenneberg made was that children in this condition who could not articulate, and also children with tracheotomies during the relevant time, perceived language just as well. There was no grammar.
Mm-hmm.
With that be surprising? Is it, first of all, is it true? Secondly, would it be surprising, given your theory of intimate relation between the motor system and the perception system?
First, this is a very, very important question. First of all, I don't know which is the level of representation that these children have. So, it is possible that they have the basic representation of the building blocks. I have no idea on this. For example, it is true that the children start understanding much earlier than when they start speaking, for example. So, the other thing is that the speech product is a multisensory stimulus which produces a lot of stimulation to the brain. So I think we can use also other cues to understand. We can also stay at the phone without looking at the person and we are almost perfectly understand what they say. So I don't have an answer to your question. I think that if we had the way to look inside the brain of these children, it would be nice to see, for example, if during perception of speech they have a motor activation, motor facilitation. This would provide probably a partial answer to your question, but
very fascinating presentation on this door opening experiment. I just have a question of information. Can these patients describe what's going on?
Yes, they know the, they know what happens.
But they know what happens, but can they use language
to describe?
Describe
in motor terms? No. In pragmatic terms, no. But if you ask them what happens, they say a guy opens the door.
Oh, yeah. So they use language to describe the scene.
Yes, yes, because
I'm
they
sorry,
are chronic patients.
So they use this description that describes the action.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So they don't say like the door is open or the door is closed and then the door is open.
This is a good question.
So that's my question, right? Do they use language to describe?
So they make. They make us understanding that they understood, okay? But I'm not sure about the form they use to communicate us this. So we have to check the video. It's a very good suggestion. It's we will check the videotapes.
No,
because
I'll talk to you about this. This is touching to my words.
This is a very good point,
yeah.
Yes.
Look up for the next question.
I'm sorry that to go to the less exciting part of your talk, not because it is less exciting, but because it is older. Both of them were exciting. You first started with the history part about the mirror neuron, and then you went to this part about the Broca stuff and your speculations. This I'll take a couple of years to process, so I cannot ask. But in the first part, you I think you still have a problem, and I wanted to ask your opinion about that. Because basically, your deceiving experiment, the one in which
you
showed that when you take away the noise,
yes,
you lose the effect, which to me it's a good experiment because it shows that probably what these neurons don't do is not exactly what you suggest they are doing. You responded to it with another experiment in which you basically increase variability of the speaker. And you say, well, if I have variability of the speaker, I still have this activation. But now what kind of response is there? Because you still are there with the same initial problem, namely, why shouldn't they? Why shouldn't they have the same effect with a single speaker without noise? If that's what the reaction is, you should have it there too. So my question is, what is exactly happening? Given the results that you gave, what this result suggests to me is that these neurons essentially serve for normalization. So they are there, you repeat into yourself, you do whatever you want with your motor system to just reinforce some kind of percept that nevertheless is independent, because otherwise you would have the same effect when you have the same speaker without noise. Mm-hmm. So you still are there and you still need to explain why you don't get this effect with single speaker without noise, which is a perfectly good language perception to begin with. Although I agree that there is no variability, but that's language perception as pure as you can imagine it. So
no, I have no problem, because as you see, when I find something that I don't like, I try to make another experiment. So I like your question. I think there are many, many possible explanations. One is the fact that the task becomes so boring because you have always the same speaker saying ba da ta and ga, and that's all, okay, for half an hour. So this is one possibility. The other possibility that the task is so easy, okay, that probably you don't need a complete involvement of the system. You can use also, let's say, only the auditory cortex to find the difference between ba and ga. But what is true in my view in your question is that, and what we don't know, is that in a sense this motor activation remembers me the attentional mechanism. A attention can be externally driven or internally generated. We have exogenous and endogenous attention. So I have nothing against the possibility that to make attention on the action of others, we use our motor system. Not only endogenously, but also exogenously driven mechanisms. So I'm not speaking about now a sort of a voluntary simulation that we use to understand the others. No, we don't make any effort. But it's so close, the similarity with attentional, let's say, for example, visual spatial attention, okay? This is known already that if you want to allocate your attention to that door, you prepare a saccadic eye movement towards that location. And this enhances the perceptual salience backwards. So it is possible. We have to better investigate. I'm not speaking anyway about an unspecific arousal effect. So I'm saying something of very specific. Anyway, sorry, just to one sentence. Intentionality is not in the sensory system. If you want to understand something, this is an intentional mechanism. You cannot enhance, okay, the sensory percept without an intentional mechanism. So,
okay, so there's time for maybe two questions. There's one question here.
I found it fascinating what you had said, but I have a very primitive question. Assume that there is someone who has the motor system severely impaired. Would that predict within your system that they would have also aphasic problems or that kind of thing?
This is the similar to the question of LIDAR. So it depends from many things. It depends from when it happens. I think that if it happens during development, the consequence might be very, very much more severe than because in adults we have many cues that we use to understand the environment. So it depends from when, it depends from where, because we know, for example, that Parkinson patients have some trouble in this kind of tasks because of the motor involvement. This is one interpretation. It could be also because of other reasons. But anyway, there is some evidence in favor of a sort of parallel behavior of the motor system in pathology and the performance in perceptual tasks. But it's not really completely convincing until now. What we did here obviously is different because you perturb with TMS a normal brain during 100 milliseconds. So we don't deal with, for example, compensation that obviously occurs after brain lesion. Remember that we have an incredible huge redundancy in our brain, okay? If you take a laptop and you make a hole in the circuit, the laptop never works, okay? But if you make a small hole in our brain, nothing happens. So we still have to understand how the machine works. But
and I think there was one last question.
Again, about the fact that you have no effect of TMS when you have no noise with your syllable stimuli. I was thinking that maybe it could be due to the fact that if you have only one speaker, you have just a few exemplars that... stimulus type that people have to learn, and it's known that we're very good at learning sound, even noises, by exposition, and that in that case you would just learn the direct association between the sound and the response. You wouldn't have to sort of decode with your motor cortex. And I was just thinking of a way of...
But this is the tongue motor cortex. This is the tongue motor cortex to answer with the finger.
Yes.
So, in which sense there is a free association between the sound and the response?
No, that was just in the sense that for sound, a syllable that you don't know, you have maybe to use your motor cortex to decode the sound which mm-hmm. you're actually finding with the noise. But in the case where you have only few different sound types, you could sure. learn the you wouldn't have to decode anymore. We have a very good memory for sounds and also for noises, for example. And maybe a way of looking at this would be to take different speakers in a situation where you have very few different sound types, like one speaker for your ba, for your da, for your ta, and contrast this with a situation where you have only one speaker. Well, play with the number of sounds, because at some point you can't memorize that many different exemplars of the syllables. And if you were to compare sort of an intermediary condition where you would have one different speaker.
Completely. I agree with you. So it's true. This is my explanation. This is partially my answer to Luca's question. So I think that this kind of task is so easy, and we are so overtrained with this kind of stimuli that obviously the motor system could or could not be involved depending upon many, many possible modification of the task, but I agree with you completely.
Well, I guess we can take one more last question before
we My question may be very stupid, but I'm only a syntactician, so... You said, if I understood, that a lesion in the Broca's area makes the patient fail to understand actions of others.
The actions.
Right?
To encode the action of others,
yeah.
Yes.
So I understand that the prediction is that if only action is involved, the patient can encode, for example, psychological states. Is that right?
Yes. So this is the reason why the title of the paper was, I don't remember it now, but I thought a lot of this. Encoding of human action in Broca's area is not understanding. Because as I told you before, when I was answering to the previous question, they understand what's happening in general terms.
Yeah, but then if you could make an experiment whether the patient could reproduce the sequence of a psychological state, right? Then the patient would do it rightly as opposed to the action. That's your prediction.
What is a sequence of psychological states?
For example, like Peter is going to marry, and then you put a sequence of liking, mental.
But you put a word, or how?
I don't know.
It's a critical point. So,
you know, it's like if you could reproduce a sequence of mental states. Well, finally, I don't know if I can find the right example. I'm a slow thinker, but no. But if you could, you know, the experiment is trying if the same way that you reproduce a sequence of door opening.
Mm-hmm.
Right? A sequence where the succession of psychological states or different stages of final psychological state.
Emotional.
I don't know how to do it, you know.
Yes.
The fear, for example. Fear like bother, but not by somebody willing to bother somebody mm-hmm. else, but as I'm bothered by the news, for example, things like this. I don't know how this experiment.
We think to this,
but
sure.
You are predicting this, right?
I have no idea, not really. Okay. I have no prediction, so we have to do it, and I have no idea, but we can think on it, sure. Thank you for the question.
So, let's thank the speaker. Mm-hmm.